Now, Mark Hitchcock will have 12 minutes for a rebuttal.
Let me begin with one of the last statements Mr. Hanegraaff made. You said Norm Geisler, who also is a preterist. I think you meant to probably say a futurist. I think you said Norm Geisler, who's a preterist. Norm Geisler is a futurist. He said, Norm Geisler wrote a very stinging critique. It's available on the internet of Mr. Hanegraaff's book, The Apocalypse Code. And I'm going to talk about this again a little bit later, but Dr. Geisler says in his critique that Mr. Hanegraaff misquoted him. Now, I'll let them figure out whether he was misquoted or not. That's an issue between them to deal with. But in the article, Norm Geisler says that he holds to the AD 95 date of Revelation, that he's held to it for 50 years. Mr. Hanegraaff just said that Norm Geisler said that the late date makes no sense. So anyway, in his own critique, Norm Geisler says that he's held to the late date for 50 years, is a statement that he made. One of the things Mr. Hanegraaff brings up is the milieu of the book of Revelation, what was going on at that time. Let's read a couple of statements here. S.R.F. Price says that it's in principle quite likely that the establishment of the cult of Domitian at Ephesus, which involved the participation of the whole province, as attested by a series of dedications by numerous cities, led to unusually great pressure on the Christians for conformity. Greg Beale concludes the evidence of pressure from the imperial cult in Asia Minor supports the Domitianic date of Revelation, but it's lacking for a pre-70 date. Elizabeth Schussler Forenza says that under the Flavians, especially Domitian, the imperial cult was strongly promoted in the Roman provinces. Domitian demanded that the populace acclaim him as Lord and God, participate in his worship. The majority of the cities to which the prophetic messages of Revelation are addressed were dedicated to the promotion of the emperor cult. Such an environment, Christians were bound to experience increasing conflicts with the imperial cult, especially since they claim Jesus Christ and not the Roman emperor as their Lord and God. Revelation knows of harassment and persecutions of individual Christians in various localities. It anticipates an increase of persecutions and suffering for the near future, not least because of the increasing totalitarianism of the reign of Domitian. So the book of Revelation and the emperor cult that Mr. Hanegraaff has mentioned really fits better under Domitian than it actually does under Nero. There was no systematic empire-wide persecution under either Nero or Domitian. But the persecution of Nero never got outside, according to secular and Christian historians, the city and the environs of the city of Rome. A couple of other things. Mr. Hanegraaff mentions Revelation 11, the temple that he believes must be intact at the time in Ezekiel 40 to 43, and how in Ezekiel an angel measures the temple, and in Revelation chapter 11, you know, John measures the temple. To me, it doesn't matter who measures the temple. The point is, Ezekiel saw a temple that was future. It didn't exist at the time he wrote. The same thing with Daniel. In Daniel 9 and in Daniel 12, he speaks of a temple and sacrifices, the sacrifices being offered and being stopped. Daniel is writing these statements almost 50 years after the Jerusalem temple has been destroyed. So he has to be talking about a future temple. And so if Daniel and Ezekiel both refer to future temples that are not existing when they're writing, we should expect John, who's often called by many people, you know, the New Testament counterpart to the book of Daniel, to do the very same thing. Also, again, Mr. Hanegraaff, you say, you know, soon means soon, near means near. Again, the book of Revelation is framed by the words soon and near. They occur at the beginning of the book. They occur at the end of the book. They're like inclusios or bookends. Everything in the book is included within the meanings of those terms. So if you say that soon means soon and near means near, as in just a few years, how did the second coming and the great white throne occur soon or near? These are events that haven't occurred yet. So whatever meaning you give to these terms, it incorporates the whole book. It's Revelation 1-3, and in Revelation chapter 22, these terms are used. Again, my view of those words is that they speak of imminency. The Lord says, or Paul says in Romans 15, you know, the Lord will soon crush Satan under your feet. Philippians 4-5 says, the Lord is near. These are statements of imminency. These are statements that these events could take place at any time, which, by the way, is a great encouragement to the people of God in every generation. Every generation that has come along reads those words, the time is near, the time is at hand, and we are encouraged by those to believe that God can break in at any time and bring the great deliverance that's promised. Another thing is Mr. Hanegraaff talks about how the final authority is the Bible and not all these people from church history. If you read any New Testament introduction by Raymond Brown, Donald Guthrie, the best known New Testament introductions you can find, every book in the New Testament is dated by external and internal evidence. Both of those are relevant. It's not an either or. The Bible is the final authority. And you've mentioned how we shouldn't listen to Eusebius because he says that John was not the author of the book of Revelation. It's interesting, in your book, The Da Vinci Code, Fact or Fiction, the Bible Answer Book, Volume 2, in your book, The Resurrection, you quote Eusebius and Irenaeus over and over again for facts from the early church, like how James, the half-brother of Jesus, his method of death, how Peter was crucified upside down. You mentioned in your book, Da Vinci Code, Fact or Fiction, you call Eusebius the first great church historian. You talk about how Irenaeus and Eusebius shed light on New Testament accuracy. So if these men are good enough to shed light on how Peter was crucified and shed light on how James, the half-brother of Jesus, died, and to shed light on historical accuracy, and you even mentioned Eusebius as one that we can look to for the establishment of the canon, then why aren't these men good enough to tell us when John wrote the book of Revelation? You can't cherry pick the sources and say in one case, well, they go against my view, so I'm not going to listen to what they say. But when they favor my view, then I'm going to take what they say. You can't do that. To me, it's against the tenets of logic and fairness and scholarship. We'll talk about that more in a little bit later. But also, this is a historical fact, the date of the book of Revelation that was passed down. This is not an interpretation of a scripture. You know, he says we wouldn't agree with the church fathers and a lot of their interpretations of scripture. This is a historical fact. It's not very hard to get right when somebody tells you that John wrote the book of Revelation, the end of Domitian's reign. And to pass that down and to have that as part of the belief of the early church. Another thing that Mr. Hanegraaff mentioned again is he said that if John had written the book of Revelation in 95 AD, he would have mentioned this event, and it's inconceivable that he wouldn't have looked back and mentioned AD 70. Again, Jesus told John specifically, write the things you've seen, which is the vision in chapter 1, write the things that are, that's in the present tense, and the things that will take place after these things. He did not say, John, write the things that were. If John would have in 95 AD written about these past events, then he would have been violating, it seems to me, the very direct command by Jesus himself of what he was to write. And I would agree with Mr. Hanegraaff that the statement of Jesus about the destruction of Jerusalem and the coming true of that statement is a great apologetic for the faith. But the book of Revelation is not an apologetics book. It's a prophecy. It says that in chapter 1, verse 3. It says it in chapter 22, verse 7 and verse 10. At the beginning and at the end, this is a prophecy. It's not a history book. It's not an apologetics book. It's a prophecy. It's talking about the future from the time that it was written. And one other thing, he mentions the seven kings in Revelation 17. It says if you start counting with Julius Caesar, you have Julius Caesar, then you have Augustus, Tiberius, then you have Caligula, then Claudius, then Nero would be the sixth king. The problem is there's just as many people saying you ought to start the counting with Augustus as to begin it with Julius Caesar. And if you do it that way, then Nero's the fifth king, and it doesn't work. In fact, there are people who say that you ought to start the counting with Caligula, the mad ruler Caligula. There, David Owney, in his commentary on Revelation, lists nine alternate schemes for counting these kings. My view is, I won't have time to go into this in detail, that these seven kings that are mentioned there are seven kingdoms. The reason I say that is if you go back to Daniel 7, in Daniel chapter 7, It says that it uses the word kings in Daniel 7:23, but these seven kings, they're kingdoms. And so Daniel 7 being the backdrop for this, I take it that those seven kings there are kingdoms. Assyria, Egypt, Babylon, Medo-Persia, and Greece, five have fallen. One is when John is writing, that is the Roman Empire. And then there's one that's still to come, which will be the ultimate empire of the Antichrist that's going to come and take place. So when I look again at the evidence of the book of Revelation, I look at these luminaries from the early church, again, the same people that Mr. Hanegraaff uses to prove all kinds of other points. These men tell us the book of Revelation was written in 95 AD. And it's not as if I just rely on external evidence. He says we ought to go to the Bible. I listed seven internal arguments that strongly suggest and in some cases necessitate a 95 date. The decline in the seven churches that had taken place, the martyrdom of this man Antipas, and the other arguments that we listed. So I'm not either or. I'm not up here saying we just look at the external evidence and just make our decision based on that. But I think we look at both. We always do that with New Testament books. And so what I believe is when you look and take both of these together, the external evidence outside the Scripture, again, this long line, I mean, Hegesippus, Irenaeus, the Victorinus, Primasius, Origen, Clement of Alexandria. When you look at what these men say, and then you compare that with what we see in the book of Revelation itself, the internal arguments, then I think it's a strong case together. Both of these point strongly toward the AD 95 date. And I think the evidence that Mr. Hanegraaff has presented in no way carries the burden. It falls far short of any burden to carry the day that the AD 65 date is true by the preponderance of the evidence. All the weight that I see is on the side of the AD 95 traditional date of Revelation. Thank you.
Now, Mr. Hanegraaff has 12 minutes to rebut Mr. Hitchcock.
And if I called Norman Geisler a preterist, my apologies. Yes, I didn't think that I could slip that by anybody here.
Well, I just want to make sure it's correct.
Norm Geisler is not a preterist. He is a futurist. He is a dispensationalist. But as far as the statement that I read, let me reread it. If you and your fellow followers write accounts of Jesus after the temple and the city are destroyed in AD 70, aren't you going to at least mention that unprecedented national, human, economic, and religious tragedy somewhere in your writings, especially since the risen Jesus had predicted it? Of course. Now, this is not between him and me, as you suggest. All you have to do is get his book. It takes too much faith to be an atheist, and you can read his long, lengthy apologetic in this regard. That book is available for anyone to read. We offer it at the Christian Research Institute. It's a great book. The evidence is in the book. This is not disputable. Let me say a couple of things about the external witness. I'm not saying that external witness is not relevant, but that the external witnesses need to be tested in light of Scripture, that the Scripture is the final court of arbitration. And I'm making an appeal to sola scriptura. That is the final court of arbitration. So I spend a whole lot less time exegeting the fathers than I do exegeting the Scriptures. But with respect to the fathers, let's talk about them for a moment. Hegesippus. I would say that Hegesippus requires interpretation, but on one point he is clear, and that is he's an exegetical eschatologist. He believes the Son of Man coming on clouds was fulfilled with the destruction of Jerusalem. Secondly, about Hegesippus, we should say that he definitely requires a tremendous amount of interpretation. Hegesippus says that Jerusalem was destroyed at the death of James. Now, by the way, there are no Hegesippus writings extant. We get this information through Eusebius. But it's very clear through the words of Eusebius that Hegesippus says that James, the brother of Jesus, is thrown from the pinnacle of the temple and subsequently stoned. Now, he doesn't die when he falls from the temple, pinnacle evidently, and he doesn't die when he's subsequently stoned. He dies after he's being clubbed to death. But James, very clearly, is the brother of Jesus, and about James, Hegesippus says that when he died, Vespasian sacks the city. Now, if you read him in a wooden literal sense, that would mean that Jerusalem and the temple were destroyed in AD 62 at the death of James, not in AD 70. My point here is simply to say Hegesippus requires interpretation. Irenaeus likewise requires interpretation. I don't only say that he was mistaken when he said Jesus died at around 50 years of age or that he had a 15-year ministry. I do think he was mistaken, but that's not the only point. There are many points that could be made with respect to Irenaeus. Irenaeus thought Peter and Paul founded the church at Rome. How many of you think that Peter and Paul founded and organized the church at Rome? Read Romans chapter 1 or read Romans chapter 15. You'll know for certain that Paul did not organize and found the church at Rome. So Irenaeus was evidently wrong or requires some kind of interpretation. I stand with my statement that Irenaeus writes a markedly ambiguous sentence in his Against Heresies. And by the way, if you've ever taken the time to try to stumble through Against Heresies, particularly when Irenaeus is dealing with the Gnostics, good luck. He's very, very difficult to interpret or understand. Now, this markedly ambiguous statement is not just based on whether it was John or John's vision that was seen during the reign of Domitian. There are a lot of different possible interpretations. It could be that the autographs themselves of Revelation were seen during the reign of Domitian. Very possibly, in context, and I spent the time reading this myself, I'm not hanging my hat on this, but this is a possible interpretation. Very possibly, he was trying to identify and solidify the number of the beast, and therefore was saying during the reign of Domitian, the autographa was still extant, and that would settle the dispute. It could be that he was talking about Domitius, the birth name of Nero. There are a lot of possibilities, but we need to learn to recognize that he is not the final court of arbitration, and he did make a lot of mistakes, one of which I find personally egregious. He believed that demons could have sex with women. And he believed that this is the explanation that we should attach to Genesis chapter 6. My point here is simply to say, if Irenaeus is right, we lose epistemic warrant for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because if demons could materialize, produce bodies and fertile sperm and have sex with women, not only should we worry about that happening now, but if that were possible, demons could have masqueraded as the resurrected Christ. And so when Christ said, "A spirit does not have flesh and bone, as you see that I have," it would have been a horribly inadequate explanation. Victorinus, if you take him at face value, John was in the mines on Patmos, experienced hard labor during the reign of Domitian when he was somewhere between 90 and 100 years old. And then, according to tradition, he carries on a fruitful ministry in Ephesus after he crosses the Aegean Sea. I think it's noteworthy that while Eusebius was a church historian, and we laud him as a church historian, and I'm not cherry-picking here, that's not my point, it's simply to say we test the fathers in light of Scripture. Do you think Eusebius was right that John is not the author of Revelation? The church fathers require interpretation. Now, with respect to soon means soon and near means near, let me first say that I have been mischaracterized as a partial preterist. I don't use that system of interpreting Scripture. In fact, Dr. LaHaye has called me a full preterist. In fact, in the Dallas Morning News, there was a statement by Dr. LaHaye saying that Hank Hanegraaff believes that Jesus Christ came back in AD 68, which must surely be one of his most creative works of fiction. I have never said such a thing, and I remember going to a great big pastors' conference in Orlando with people waving the newspapers and saying, "You're not coming to my church again." Absolutely false. I am not a full preterist, and I am not a partial preterist. Soon means soon, and near means near. And what I mean by that is simply this. Jesus is not linguistically challenged. He is using the language of the Old Testament prophets. He is the heir to the linguistic riches of the Old Testament prophets and a greater theologian than them all. And he's speaking in the manner of the Old Testament prophets. He's speaking about an apocalypse that is looming on the horizon, and he's associating vindication for true Israel in this apocalypse with vindication in the eschaton. Each one of you, even now, knows that that is how the Old Testament prophets spoke. Why can't John speak that way? Again, this will be underscored as the debate continues. Now, as far as starting with Augustus, as opposed to starting with Julius Caesar, the father of the Roman Empire, again, I want to be biblical here. I don't want to use a historical paradigm for setting the seven kings. I want to be biblical. And that is why I underscored in my opening remarks the fact that the Bible refers to kings as Caesar. And Caesar is the family name of Julius, which makes Julius Caesar the first Caesar. And I also augmented my comments by saying that Suetonius, Josephus, Dio Cassius, and the sibling oracles make the same point. Now, I spent a lot of time studying the Caesars because my daughter Christina, who is 14, loves Roman history. And so I've had to stay up with her. And I've spent a lot of time on this subject. And I think that from a biblical standpoint in particular, we are on safe ground to say that Julius Caesar was, in fact, as the father of the Roman Empire, the first Caesar. It's his family name. Now, again, I'm not arguing here for an either-or proposition. I'm not saying that the fathers are not relevant. I'm not saying that the fathers are not important. But where the fathers stray from Scripture, I stray from the fathers. I will never accept baptismal regeneration. I will never accept the perpetual virginity of Mary. And I will never demonize Jews as the fathers did in the centuries following the death of Christ. When the Jews cried, "His blood be on us and our children," it wasn't the children who were punished for the sins of the fathers. Each person is held culpable, at least biblically, for their own sins.
Hank's first question for Mark is, in your co-authored book titled Extraterrestrials, you cite early church fathers such as Irenaeus as external evidence for your contention that fallen angels can materialize, take on human bodies, and have sex with women. For example, you cite the words of Justin Martyr, quote, the angels transgressed and were captivated by love for women and beget children, unquote, as evidence that demons not only have the wherewithal to have sex, but to impregnate women who in turn give birth to gigantic offspring. In like fashion, in late dating Revelation, you appeal to tradition of early church fathers such as Irenaeus, Justin Martyr, and Eusebius to late date the writing of the book of Revelation to the time of Domitian. While church fathers have certainly made noteworthy contributions, many of the early traditions, including baptismal regeneration, have had negative consequences. Irenaeus believed that Jesus died when he was nearly 50 years of age, and Eusebius denied that Revelation was written by the Apostle John. Since the traditions such as demons materializing, having sex with women, and producing gigantic offspring make epistemic warrant for the resurrection and ultimately the deity of our Lord in traditions such as those of Eusebius and Dionysius call into question the apostolic authorship and origin of the book of Revelation, would it not be more circumspect to place greater evidential weight on the internal evidence of the infallible text as opposed to external evidence based on fallible traditions?
This is a question about the place really of external evidence in dating New Testament books. I have three responses. First in this question, Mr. Hanegraaff begins with Justin Martyr and his view of Genesis 6, which by the way has nothing to do with the date of Revelation. And then he says that I appeal to tradition of early church fathers such as Irenaeus, Justin Martyr, and Eusebius to late date the writing of the book of Revelation. However, I never mentioned Justin Martyr as evidence for the late date. Anyone who's familiar with the external evidence knows Justin Martyr did not deal with the date of Revelation as far as we know. This is an incorrect statement. It's a factual error. Mr. Hanegraaff had a copy of my dissertation for several months before he wrote these questions, and I don't appeal to Justin Martyr as he says. Second, both external and internal evidence are always used in dating New Testament books. Both are relevant. It's not either or. Again, read any New Testament introduction. As you've seen, I do not ignore the internal evidence. The internal evidence also proves the AD 95 date, but the overwhelming external evidence comes alongside and serves as powerful confirmation that our view of the internal evidence is correct. The reason Mr. Hanegraaff wants to discount the importance of the external evidence when it comes to the date of Revelation is that it goes strongly against his view. Now third, as I mentioned earlier, Mr. Hanegraaff frequently uses the very same sources he criticizes. In the Da Vinci Code Fact or Fiction, he appeals in a chapter that he wrote to Irenaeus that he sheds light on the New Testament accuracy. In the same book, he calls Eusebius the first church historian, that he gives abundant evidence that the canon was well established before the time of Constantine. Again, on page 62 of that book, he gives the tradition that Peter was crucified upside down, and that Eusebius describes how James was thrown from the pinnacle of the temple and subsequently stoned. In the Bible Answer Book, Volume 2, he quotes Irenaeus and Eusebius in support of New Testament historical accuracy. And twice in his book, Resurrection, he cites Irenaeus and cites Eusebius for historical facts. In his book, The Apocalypse Code, Mr. Hanegraaff questions the clarity and reliability of Irenaeus on page 153 concerning his testimony about the date of Revelation. Yet just 13 pages earlier on page 140, he cites Irenaeus approvingly as a source that the Apostle John was the author of the book of Revelation. If Irenaeus is good enough for Mr. Hanegraaff to use as a source for the authorship of Revelation, why isn't he a good source 13 pages later for when the book was written? Mr. Hanegraaff's blatant inconsistency is apparent. How can one legitimately use Irenaeus as a source for who wrote Revelation and turn around 13 pages later and tear down the reliability of the very same witness concerning the date of Revelation? This is contrary to the basic tenets of logic, fairness, and scholarship. Mr. Hanegraaff uses external sources when they help his case, but then turns around and dismisses the very same sources as unnecessary or unreliable when they go against his view. This cherry-picking of sources to suit his own purposes undermines his method and his conclusion concerning the date of Revelation. Also, isn't it ironic that Mr. Hanegraaff's own argument goes against him here? He dismisses the testimony of Irenaeus because he made one mistake about the length of Jesus' ministry. Yet in this very question, Mr. Hanegraaff makes a factual error concerning Justin Martyr as a source for the date of Revelation. following Mr. Hanegraaff's own logic, we should dismiss everything he says as well. Now, I'm not saying we ought to do that. I'm just saying if you followed his logic, then if a person makes a factual error like this, then you should dismiss what they say. Again, it's not either or with external evidence and internal evidence. I've given seven arguments that he's yet to refute from internal evidence for the book of Revelation and the external evidence. When you put both of those together, it's, I believe, a strong, if not an overwhelming case for the traditional Domitianic or the late date, AD 95 date for Revelation.
Now, Mr. Hanegraaff will answer Mark Hitchcock's question, which is as follows.
He has a minute to respond.
Oh, that's right. I'm sorry. Yeah. Go ahead, Hank. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I just say that very clearly, if you were listening to me, I didn't suggest in any sense that we should dismiss what the Church Fathers say. What I'm saying is that the Church Fathers require interpretation. And I think that Irenaeus, Eusebius, Victorinus, Hegesippus, they all made substantial factual errors, or if you read them in a wooden literal sense, you're going to mistake their meaning. So they require interpretation. I'm not suggesting you can't use them as evidence. I'm simply saying that you have to interpret the fathers, and I think that we are far better off then learning how to exegete the scriptures, because Irenaeus, for example, in the prologue to my question, made an egregious error in suggesting that demons could have sex with women. If this is true, we lose epistemic warrant for the central event in the Christian faith, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and vicariously lose warrant for the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. So ideas have consequences. The ideas promoted by the Church Fathers had dramatic consequences.
Okay, now here is Mr. Hitchcock's question for Mr. Hanegraaff. External evidence plays an important role in dating the books of the New Testament. How do you explain the fact that Hegesippus, Irenaeus, Victorinus, Eusebius, Jerome, Servetus, and Primesius all support the AD 95 date, and that no one prior to AD 500 explicitly supports the mid-60s Neronic date of Revelation?
I find it highly ironic that I would be asked this question by Dr. Hitchcock, in that the pre-tribulational theory, which is at the heart of this debate, didn't surface until the 19th century. Now, this is not my opinion. Dr. Harry Ironside, who Dr. LaHaye says is a hero of his, preaching hero of his, and justifiably so, says this. He says, search the so-called fathers, pre- and post-Nicene, the scholastic divines, the Roman Catholic writers of all shades of thought, the reformers, the Puritans, and they will find the mystery conspicuous by its absence.
You can mark it.
Now, this was a point that I think was pretty much conceded until Grant Jeffrey spent 10 years combing the archives of history and came up with what he calls an electrifying discovery. Ephraim the Syrian, supposedly as a church father, believed in the pre-tribulational rapture. Now, it so turns out that is absolutely false. And to his credit, Dr. LaHaye has conceded that point and now says that it wasn't Ephraim the Syrian, it was Pseudo-Ephraim, written in the 6th or 7th century. By the way, I'm not just making this up. The fact of the matter is, this is a point now conceded, even though people like Norm Geisler still attribute pre-tribulational rapturism with Ephraim the Syrian in the 4th century. Well, nothing could be farther from the truth, and even if it was true, there's no pre-tribulational rapture tradition that grew up around it. Not only that, but if you read Pseudo-Ephraim, you will find out that Pseudo-Ephraim did not, in any sense, teach a pre-tribulational rapture. Read his 10-point sermon. He doesn't do it. We do not have any writings, for example, in which Hegesippus explicitly supports a late date for Revelation. Nor do we have any evidence that Eusebius believed that Hegesippus held to a late date. It's all just speculation on the part of Dr. Hitchcock. And there are many things better than speculation. Clement of Alexandria, for example, says Revelation ceased at the time of Nero. As such, the canon would have had to be completed during the reign of Nero. Maybe that's not explicit, it's at least implicit, and it's a whole lot better than speculation.
That's it.
Well, I thought you were giving me a
1 minute.
Well, the only other thing I would add to this, and I think it's a significant point, and that is there are many traditions, and Dr. Hitchcock was kind enough to mention that. There's not just two traditions in the early church with respect to the dating of the book of Revelation. There's at least four traditions. You have the tradition of Claudius, written during the reign of Claudius, Nero, Domitian, and even Trajan. Much more could be said, but I'm out of time.
1 minute.
Up here. First of all, about the pre-trib rapture, a pseudo-Ephraim refers to the pre-trib rapture. We still maintain that. Brother Dulcino in the 1300s held to a pre-trib rapture. Morgan Edwards, the founder of Brown University. Francis Gummerlach has told me personally that he has two file drawers full of pre-trib rapture statements that he's yet to translate from Latin. So there are a lot of historical antecedents to pre-trib rapture. What about Irenaeus? So you're talking about Hegesippus and all this. Irenaeus makes a clear statement that the book of Revelation was written near the end of the reign of Domitian. And the first person, you talk about these four traditions, Epiphanius mentions it under Claudius. That can't be true. The seven churches didn't even exist. We know that's wrong. One guy mentions under Trajan. And the first evidence for the Neronic date is 508 AD. These are the witnesses for the 65 date. These are the witnesses for the 95 date again.
Now, Mr. Hanegraaff's second question to Mark Hitchcock. In sharp distinction to your contention that many New Testament epistles, including Revelation, were written long after AD 70, dispensational heavyweight Dr. Norman Geisler argues convincingly that most, if not all, the books of the New Testament canon must have been written prior to AD 70. Says Geisler, if you and your fellow followers write accounts of Jesus after the temple and the city are destroyed, aren't you going to at least mention that unprecedented tragedy somewhere in your writings, especially since this risen Jesus predicted it? Of course, unquote. Dr. Geisler, though a dispensationalist, I might add he's a member of the Pre-Trib Study Group, recognizes that had Revelation been written after this apocalypse, the Apostle John would have certainly have referenced it. Thus, he cites Revelation 11 to underscore the fact that, quote, the New Testament documents speak of Jerusalem and the temple as if they were still intact at the time of the writings, unquote. Ironically, in your dissertation, you cite as the first of your reasons that John would not have mentioned the fulfillment of this most notable prophecy that, quote, in AD 95, 25 years after the fact, the destruction of the Jewish temple would have had little relevance for predominantly Gentile churches that were approximately 800 miles from Jerusalem, unquote. Yet, as you well know, the fulfillment of Jesus' prophecy concerning the destruction of the temple, like the resurrection of our Lord, has had enormous apologetic significance throughout church history. Indeed, alongside evidences for the resurrection, it is a primary apologetic for the deity of Christ. Why then do you argue that a prophetic fulfillment that validates the essential Christian doctrine of the deity of Christ, quote, would have little relevance, unquote, for Gentile believers in Asia Minor?
Well, I have two responses to this question. First, Dr. Norman Geisler, in a very negative review of Mr. Hanegraaff's book, The Apocalypse Code, has stated clearly that he's always held that Revelation was written in AD 95. Dr. Geisler says, in particular, the code also takes the quote from our book out of context in an attempt to support their view by showing that I believe John was written before AD 70. I never said any such thing. I was merely emphasizing that most, if not all, of the New Testament was written early. I never said, nor do I believe, that John wrote Revelation before AD 70. I've held the late date for John's gospel and the apocalypse for the last 50 years. So, dispensational heavyweight Dr. Norman Geisler disagrees with Mr. Hanegraaff's view of the date of the book of Revelation, and apparently believes that he took his statements out of context to try to claim him for support for his view. And again, I'll leave that issue for you and Dr. Geisler to settle. Second, Mr. Hanegraaff continues to harp on this idea that if Revelation was written after AD 70, John would have been required to mention it. This is the gist of his first two towers in defense of the AD 65 date. There are three reasons why John made no mention of the events in AD 70 when he wrote the book of Revelation in AD 95. Revelation, again, was written to a primarily Gentile audience 25 years after AD 70, 800 miles from Jerusalem. This event would have had little relevance to them. Notice I said little relevance, not no relevance. Of course, the destruction of the temple in AD 70 has apologetic importance for the church. But Revelation, my second point is a prophecy, not an apologetics book or a history book. It defines itself that way in 1:3 and in 22:7 and 10. Revelation does not mention any fulfilled prophecies.